Good morning, and welcome to Cleveland Park Congregational United Church of Christ. We are an open and affirming congregation committed to racial justice. Whoever you are and wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. If you're in the sanctuary, please remember to mute your devices. If you're on Zoom, please mute yourselves. If you have a name tag, please wear it. It's a lot friendlier at coffee hour. A few announcements this morning. After church today, after coffee hour, is December's council meeting. Anyone who would like to can join. We'll be providing updates on committees and work. And tis the season for lots of Christmas announcements. So on Saturday, deck the halls. You can come join us and help get the sanctuary ready for the festive pageant and Christmas Eve. If you have prunings of evergreens or berries that you can bring, please drop them off by the 15th or Saturday morning, and then come anytime between 9:30 and noon to help decorate. Our Christmas pageant is next Sunday, the most wonderful time of the year. Any children can participate. If you show up, you'll be part of the pageant. It's the best thing about it. There's a role for everyone. And Christmas Eve is on a Sunday this year, so we'll have two services, 10:30 a.m. the parlor at our usual time, and 7:30 p.m. also. I'm sorry, both of them are in the sanctuary, 10:30 in the morning. Oh, I'm sorry, I was reading that right. I was second-guessing myself. 10:30 in the parlor, 7:30 in the sanctuary. Come to one, come to both, come to either, it's your choice. And a final Christmas announcement, I think Ashley wants to talk about the Secret Santa gifts.
Thank you so much. Today is the day that hopefully you brought your Christmas gifts back to worship for Shaw Community Center. If you forgot, don't worry. Just find me during the coffee hour and we can coordinate for a pickup drop off sometime this week. The holiday party at Shaw is next Saturday, so we do have a couple of days to get the gifts there, but it's just easiest if we get them all today, more or less. So just find me if you happen to forget. If you brought it, bring it over to me during coffee hour and we will be collecting under the tree.
Thank you so much, Ashley and Heidi. And welcome, everyone. It is really good to see you on this second Sunday of Advent. I keep getting off because it is, not that I want to scare anyone, literally 15 days until Christmas, so how can it only be the second Sunday of Advent? But, you know, it's all kind of compacted this year, as I said last week, and that's okay. John C. got his Christmas tree this morning despite the rain. We're continuing with our theme, How Does a Weary World Rejoice? And today's service is going to focus on Mary, or Miriam, and her powerful prophetic voice. I welcome the light. Callie and Maggie will begin our worship by lighting candles of hope and healing for the world. And we pray that this light will illumine all places, beings, and situations without exception, near and far. Please join me in the call to worship. How does a weary world rejoice? We allow them to change us without and within. We resist the temptation to give up or give in. We gather for worship, embracing one another. And together we pray, God of the impossible, we bring our hesitant selves to you. We ask for the courage to follow Mary, echoing her song. Like the prophets before her, she declared what the world could be, should be. She must have been scared, but spoke out anyway. She carried the word and didn't back down. This morning, We hear her praise you for turning injustice on its head, lifting up the poor and hungry, comforting the sick and weary-hearted, and tending the lonely and the lost. Inspire us to stand with her, then plant a fire in our hearts. We know we are your body in this world, and with Mary, we yearn to create a better one. Amen. Before I invite you to our opening hymn, I just need to say to those online, with great apologies, we are still having trouble showing the slides on Zoom, though folks are able to see them in the sanctuary. We apologize for this. We're working with Mark Turner to try to correct it. And we give thanks, as always, for our worship tech volunteers who are trying so hard to bring hybrid to us all. And now please rise in body and or spirit as you are able for our opening hymn found on page 130. I want to say also that, you know, it's always important to express gratitude. So first, expressing gratitude to all of you who came out in the rainstorm this morning. And second, expressing gratitude that the rainy, chilly weather has converged with our boiler working and it's warm in here. Yes, and thank you to all of our volunteers, our building and grounds folks, and Meg for making that happen. So as I said last week, Advent is a season of preparation for Christmas, as Lent is a season of preparation for Easter. In both, part of the preparation is to confess and seek forgiveness for that which we'd like to let go or do differently. So during Advent, we're going to share a communal prayer of confession each Sunday. I now invite you to pray. Holy One, some days we forget that, like Mary, we are highly favored, beloved. Help us to trust in your holy hug and forgive us when we think we're unworthy or don't need your embrace. We are called to carry your light in the world, but some days we dim ourselves and downplay our ability to make a difference. Forgive us and help us to remember Mary's courageous song, that we may sing and live her words of hope and justice each day. Amen. Dear ones, no matter how many times we set down hope and forget we are loved, we are God's beloved, and we never know the end of the story. So please say with me, I am beloved. I am forgiven. I make a difference. And now, held in the arms of this love, let us pray. God who calls and comforts, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I now invite all those online to unmute and those in the sanctuary to turn and share the peace and love of God with your neighbor in the pew. May peace be with you.
I'm looking for you.
I just started the video.
Okay. I think that picture they have of me is not very good, though.
Oh, you're not on. You're not on. You're
good. Thank you.
Yeah. Peace be with you all.
Absolutely.
Wow, you're already seated. I was using the opportunity to go get something that I forgot for our time for all ages, which I now have. So whoever would like to come up, young at heart, anybody who would like to come forward for our time for all ages, I invite you now. Hi, Lila. Lila doesn't want to be alone. Right, there we go. Hi, Stella. Hi, Layla. Interesting, huh? Does anyone know what this is? Actually, let's see. Serena, do you have the microphone there? Thank you so much. Does anyone know what this is? Can you see? Turn around and look. You know what this is? It is a menorah. Yeah. Is there any reason I might have a menorah here today?
To
Do you know what season it is for Jewish people?
Hanukkah?
It is, in fact, Hanukkah. It is. And you know, the second Sunday of Advent for Christians is the Sunday of peace. And we don't have a whole lot of that in the world right now, in a lot of different places, honestly. But particularly at this time of year, the part of the world that both Christians and Jewish people call the Holy Land is in a lot of distress. There's a lot of violence there. The Holy Land is the area of sort of Israel-Palestine that Jesus lived and, you know, wandered around during his life. Okay? And so the land that we call holy is just having a whole lot of violence and terror and war. And yet it's the second Sunday of Advent, which is our Peace Sunday. See, I'm always jumping ahead. It's our second Sunday of Advent, which is our Peace Sunday. And it is the third day of Hanukkah. Tonight is the fourth night of Hanukkah. But since all Jewish holidays begin at sundown, we're still on the third day of Hanukkah. And so, what I wanted to talk about a little bit today is how we can pull out the best parts of our traditions. Because, friends, all religious traditions have scripture verses and rituals that promote peace and love and connection and compassion. And all religious traditions have parts of themselves that don't do that, that are about we're better than other people, or we have the truth and they don't, or this is our land, not theirs. And the reason that that is because religion is practiced by human beings. And human beings have all of that in ourselves. We have love in ourselves, we have peace, we have kindness, and that is so awesome. And those are the things we want to cultivate and grow. But we also have those icky parts of ourselves that can be mean to each other and bullying and snarky and violent. Yeah. And so what I say is, let's pull out the best parts, the most loving parts, the most kind parts of all of our traditions and celebrate those and share them with one another. And so today, not only are we going to light the first and second candles of Advent for hope and peace, but also we're going to talk about this middle candle on the menorah. You'll notice that 9 spots on the menorah, not 7, friends. That is not a Hanukkah menorah, that is a regular menorah. There are 9 spots on the menorah for the 8 nights of Hanukkah, and then 1 spot in the middle. That spot is for this candle. Does anybody know what this candle is? It's called the Shamash. It's the helper candle. That's what this candle is. This is the candle that every single night lights all of the other candles. It's the helper candle. And so what if we could each be the helper candle that's spreading the light? We just talked at the beginning of the service about our candles of hope and healing for the world. What if we could each be the helper candle that spreads the light to everyone else? And so I am wondering, we're gonna need help with lighting the, That's all right, gremlins exist. We're gonna need help lighting the Advent candles of hope and peace, and we're also going to need somebody who wants to take the Shamash, or helper candle, and light the candles for the first 3 days of Hanukkah. So do I have any volunteers? Layla, what would you like to do? Stella, do you have a preference? Kind of same? Same, okay. I know, Lila,
Would you like to come and help me light the Hanukkah candles? Yeah? All right, come on over. We'll do it together. And then Layla and Stella can light the two Advent candles. All right, we're going to do this together, okay? Hold my hand. There we go. All right, you're going to light the candles from right to left, because that's how you read Hebrew. There you go. One, two. Beautiful. Whoops, that one doesn't want to light quite quickly. That's all right. Sometimes the light takes a while to spread. And three. Thank you. Perfect. Thank you so much. And then we put the helper candle back in the middle so that it's ready to help more. There we go. Okay. So now Marian and I are going to read the words for peace, for the peace candle this Sunday, and then we'll have Stella and Layla light them, okay? All right. Give you a mic, so I'll put it up here. Let's see, here we go. You'll do the bold, okay. Sounds great. How does a weary world practice peace?
By listening before we speak, and saying sorry when we need to.
By advocating for justice and caring for our neighbor. By practicing Sabbath and forgiving 70 times 7.
By choosing grace over hate and opening the door for each other.
There are a million ways to practice peace. So today we light the candle of peace as a reminder and a charge.
With God's help, may we bring peace to a weary world. Amen.
All right. So now we're going to have and first, we need somebody to light the candle of hope, which is the candle that's already been lit. Stella, do you want to do that one?
Sure.
Okay. It's the one that's already been lit, and then
so
Layla, you'll
this
do
one?
This one right here.
Oh,
yep. You got it. The candle of hope. May it burn brightly. And then light, no, actually, because she's going to light also. So, and then then you can pull it back if you want. Right there. The candle of peace. May it fill our hearts. And now you can push it down. Just pull it down a little bit so that it extinguishes, but not so far. But there, perfect. You got it. Thank you.
Now we have a smoke.
Now we've got, right, well, some say that the smoke is the light going everywhere, you know, so. Thank you. Oh, I have a picture of a whale. That is beautiful, a rainbow whale. Thank you, Lila. All right, okay, so anybody who's going down with Marian to have a great Sunday school class, enjoy. And I now welcome Alan to read from the Gospel of Luke.
In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a young woman, to a man whose name was Joseph, engaged to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. The young woman's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one, the Holy One is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Holy One will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am with no man?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. And now your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month for her who was said to be barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." Then Mary said, "Here I am. Here am I, the servant of the Holy One. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her. In those days, Mary set out and went with haste to a Judean town in the hill country, where she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit and exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why has this happened to me, that the mother of my God comes to me? For as soon as I heard the sound of your greeting, the child in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her by the Holy One." And Mary said, "My soul magnifies God, and my spirit rejoices in the divine, for she has looked with favor on the lowly state of her servant. Surely from now on all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is her name. Indeed, God's mercy is for those who fear God from generation to generation. The Holy One has shown strength with his arm and has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. She has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has come to the aid of his child Israel in remembrance of his mercy, according to the promise made to our ancestors, to Abraham and to his descendants forever." And Mary remained with Elizabeth about 3 months and then returned to her home.
Thank you, Alan.
Thank you. Thank you, Alan. And just a few notes on my scripture, on that scripture passage before I begin my sermon. One is that Elizabeth is a relative of Mary and the wife of Zechariah, who featured in last week's sermon. And the child who leapt in her womb is the baby that will grow up to be John the Baptist. So just a little bit of additional context. Well, most of us know the section of Luke's gospel that Alan just read. We've heard it in Christmas pageants, lessons and carols, TV Christmas specials, and more. We've seen it portrayed in paintings, stained glass windows, frescoes, and mosaics. And we've read it in novels, children's books, and of course, the Bible. It's familiar. But sometimes the familiar can be problematic, because it's easy to lose or reduce the original message of the story and the acculturated portrayals that come down to us over the centuries. Beautiful Mary, humble Mary, head bowed and accepting Mary. Is this really who she was? Is it even who Luke or his gospel was trying to portray? This morning, I'm going to take three looks at Mary, or Miriam, as she would have been called in her time and place. Three different lenses through which we can view her story. The first is a feminist or liberation lens that prioritizes a concern for the portrayal of a young woman child who's given no say in whether or not she'll conceive and carry a child. This Mary is at the mercy of the patriarchal, religious, and cultural world in which she lives, She has no real choice in whom she marries, whether she marries, and whether she conceives and carries the child. If she conceives the child out of wedlock, she'll be shunned, scorned, possibly stoned. This Mary has no real choice whether she carries the godchild, Jesus. For the angel says, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. Now, Mary ultimately concedes, let it be with me according to your word, but what else could she say? An angel of the Lord has told her God is going to impregnate her in a cultural context that gives her no choice in the matter regardless. As the poet and ex-evangelical Caitlin Shetler writes, and I'm going to, like, quick caveat, this is a hard poem. They gift our girls with purity rings that they be full of grace instead of choice and grit. Then they shame our girls for pregnancies, which is a funny way to pay homage to a bastard god. She barely agreed to bear the divine, but church rarely has time to talk consent when a woman's body is involved. I don't doubt Mary's song, just the tune, because you can still magnify the things that frighten you and call holy powers that oppress. I want to believe in the agency of a young virgin child, in a God that sought her blessing instead of compliance, but that story's not found in blue books behind pews, but in the grit of the girls shamed for their choice. And I keep looking for them, but they were kicked out. There's no room in an inn built for kings and wise men, because ego can't stand mothers of God. Now, this poem packs a punch, but it's important because Caitlin comes from a world that uses Mary to oppress women and girls. And while our children may not get this message here in our church, they're surely hearing it throughout our culture. And honestly, isn't it the story even we typically tell? That Mary was chosen by God to carry Jesus, so she did. God didn't ask her permission. God didn't ask for consent. And we make it clear Mary was young. We make it clear she was vulnerable. We make it clear she was a virgin. How is this okay? So that's the first lens. And it's a challenging one. But it's important to see what sort of story we're perpetuating, what sort of story has been passed down through the ages. Mary, meek and mild. Mary, the virgin. Mary, the perfect mother, because she was a virgin. Mary, chosen by God because she was so pure and didn't protest and did what she is told. Is this the message we want our children to hear? The problem is, even biblically, it's not the whole story. So our second lens is going to look at what this gospel story actually contains, the parts we often ignore. I mean, how many Christmas pageants include the Magnificat? Ours will this year. And what is the Magnificat? It's Mary's powerful prophetic song that echoes the prophet Hannah, the mother of Samuel. Hannah, like Elizabeth, Mary's cousin, was barren, which in their cultural context and ours meant a woman shamed. And like Elizabeth, she conceived in older age. Here's an excerpt from Hannah's song. My heart exults in the Lord, my strength is exalted in my God. There is no holy one like the Lord, no one beside you. There is no rock like our God. Talk no more so very proudly. Let not arrogance come from your mouth, for the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. The bows of the mighty are broken, but the feeble gird on strength. Those who were full have hired themselves out for bread, but those who were hungry are fat with spoil. The barren has borne seven, but she who has many children is forlorn. The Lord kills and brings to life. He brings down to Sheol and raises up. The Lord makes poor and makes rich. He brings low, he also exalts. He raises up the poor from the dust. He lifts the needy from the ash heap to make them sit with princes and inherit a seat of honor. That's Hannah's song in the Hebrew Bible or Old Testament. Now here an excerpt from the Magnificat, noting that our version uses inclusive language. My soul magnifies God, and my spirit rejoices in the divine. For the Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is her name. Indeed, God's mercy is for those who fear God from generation to generation. The Holy One has shown strength with his arm and has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. She has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. Now, while not identical, whoever wrote Mary's song surely had Hannah's words in mind. And Hannah is considered a prophet because she speaks for God and challenges the way things are. Mary, too, is a prophet. Her words challenge the social order. They proclaim that life and hierarchy and patriarchy and empire as we know them are not the way of God. They powerfully emphasize that God's realm looks different and we had better get with the program. The second lens moves us away from Mary, meek and mild, toward Mary as empowered and powerful. Because while it's true that we don't always have a choice in what happens to us, we do always have agency. We can make choices in the context of our circumstances. And not only did Mary courageously choose to go find connection and community with her cousin Elizabeth, which, by the way, would have been a long journey by foot for a young woman to make alone. Not only did she choose to find that connection and community, which must have taken courage, she prophesied. She spoke out against empire, against the way things are, and proclaimed how they could be. Why don't we teach our children this? The third lens reminds us these are stories. When we read the gospel accounts of the birth, life, and death of Jesus, we need to remember they were written well after his death by people who had never met him. Of course, there was ample oral tradition and even written testimony from which the four canonical gospels drew, but each group of writers wrote for their own communities and had specific points they were trying to make about who Jesus was and what was most important about his life and message. For instance, the Gospels of Mark and John contain no birth narrative. Did you know that? And the Gospels of Luke and Matthew have very different birth narratives. There's no Magnificat or story of Elizabeth and Zechariah in Matthew, and there's no very long genealogical list or Magi in Matthew, in Luke. What we think of as the nativity story is really a mashup, leaving out a lot of parts of these two gospel versions. Again, they're stories, not historical fact. And like any story, their message lies not in what factually happened, since much of it likely did not, but in the meaning we find. Thus, my third lens acknowledges this and asks, what does Mary's story mean? When I think about the Bible in the context of our Protestant tradition, I think of the Word. As the Gospel of John starts, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. We humans come to one another with language and stories, and we make meaning of our lives through narrative. But we're also bodies. And so this third lens views Mary as a very human body carrying the Word in multiple ways. She carried Jesus, which means she was a vessel for the Word, a more traditional view. And she herself carried the Word, which we hear through her powerful prophecy, the Magnificat. In her cultural context, I find it ironic that her word is amplified by the silencing of Zechariah, about which I preached last week. How's this for something to teach our children? That a young woman child in first century Palestine not only carried the word of God, but her voice was given prominence over the voice of an elderly temple priest. Mary carried the word. Mary prophesied the word, and the point of prophecy is to move us, to challenge those of us who hear this word, to change the way we live. And Mary does this, but only if we can hear her. If we insist on seeing her as meek and mild and virginal and fragile, we lose her voice. But if we can see her as bold and terrified and strong and wild hair and willing to carry and proclaim God's word, even though it was culturally dangerous and potentially life-threatening, we understand who she really was and can be moved by what the Christmas story actually is. A powerful testimony to the importance of raising our voice, of speaking truth to power, and overcoming the silence of oppression. Friends, we each have the capacity to carry the word. We each have the potential to give birth to the voice of God. Even and especially when it's culturally dangerous and potentially life-threatening. The story of Miriam shows us the way. Will we follow? Amen. Just take a moment of meditation before our sermon hymn. The words on the screen are the third verse of O Holy Night, which I referenced last Sunday. The third verse being one highlighted by abolitionists before the Civil War. You'll find our sermon hymn on the screen or on an insert in your order of service. Thank you.
is now the time in our service when we share our deep joys and concerns, silently or out loud, with God and with one another. I'll share some of those who've already received blessing and posted in the chapel,
and then invite you in the sanctuary to share. God, hear our healing prayers for Vanessa's parents who were in a bad car accident this weekend. Julie Martin's dad who will be having triple or quadruple bypass surgery this month, and all who are managing major health concerns. God, hear our prayers for the family and friends of Kristen's friend Susanna who died this week. For all those who live with disabilities, with the hope that all of us will advocate for policy changes to remove obstacles to their living, working, and thriving. For Jane's friend Kay and his mother, who lives alone and has fallen twice, that she'll decide to see a doctor. For all those in Ukraine, Palestine, Israel, Sudan, Congo, Ethiopia, and elsewhere who are in harm's way. All who are grieving the loss of loved ones, and anyone anywhere who is sick or grieving or in need. If you have a concern that you'd like to share, please raise your hand and we'll bring you the microphone. Nancy.
Two concerns. First of all, for my dear friend Susan, whose partner Laird is losing his longtime struggle with cancer. And second, my grandniece Amelia and my entire family. Amelia is 7 and in the thick of chemotherapy.
Thank you, Nancy. Our prayers are with them and with you. Other concerns? Okay, we'll move to Joyce. God, we give thanks for the miracle of Julie Martin's dad being alive, though he has multiple blocked arteries. We also give thanks for Anne's mother, who has stage 4 pancreatic cancer and is doing better than expected and possibly eligible for a new clinical trial. And we give thanks for all those who devote their lives to creating peace, joy, and justice in this world. Other joys. Lee.
I'm really happy that my boyfriend TJ is here with us today. I hope you'll welcome him.
Welcome, TJ. You're very welcome.
Two Sundays ago, I was in Scottsdale, Arizona, and I was looking for a church. I was visiting my son and daughter-in-law and grandson. And I went online and I found a couple of congregational churches in Scottsdale. And when I looked at both of them, I chose one. And I chose it because they listed 10 things that might surprise you about us. And every single one of those things was here at Cleveland Park Church. And so if you are visiting Scottsdale, I recommend the Scottsdale Congregational UCC Church. It is a smaller version, Southwest style, of our church. The choir was not singing that Sunday, but they had a professional jazz pianist there. And the music was superb. Every Thursday evening, they actually have jazz sessions. They do social justice projects and everything. So yeah, if you go to Scottsdale, you've got a place to go.
All right, excellent. And maybe we should have 10 things that might surprise you about us on our website.
Just go online and look at that list. It makes you smile.
Wonderful. Thank you, Lee. Other joys. Well, I'll share a joy that Mark and two of my boys, Tate and Nick, have been up with Mark's mother, Oksana, this weekend in celebration of her 89th birthday. Okay, let us pray. Loving God, listen to the prayers of your people. Comfort and nourish us in both our joys and our concerns, spoken or unspoken, and hold us tenderly as we face the many different experiences that life and being human can bring. Holy and gracious Spirit, we are grateful for your presence as we move into this new week, a time that will bring forth its own sorrows and joys. Remind us to hold one another in love and prayer, reaching out as we are able, to lend a hand, offer support, or share in celebration. We give thanks for the blessing of this congregation in our lives and pray that we might be a blessing to others in return. In your compassionate name, amen. I invite you to hold all of these joys and concerns in your heart as the choir shares their musical offering with us. Thank you. This is now the time in our service when we receive the offering in grateful appreciation for the life and work of this beloved community. To support the ongoing work of our church, I ask that you please give in person, via mail, or online as you are able. If you're in the sanctuary, you can contribute as the offering plate is passed, or take out your phone and scan the QR code on the back of our worship bulletin, which will take you to our donate page. If you've already donated, thank you. I invite you to take one of the offering cards in the pew racks and put it in the plate as a symbol of your giving. For those on Zoom, as always, the link to our donate page is in the chat room. Many thanks for everything you give to this church community, money, energy, time, and spirit. Remain standing for our commission closing hymn and sung benediction. Thank you. This morning I send us forth with these words from the poet Liesl Graham. Some of us make it a habit to be the light. How we wrap ourselves in peace at the end of each moment, learning to inhale the cup of air that lives inside the pause, that thin place where things are often lost. See how our fingers are bleeding from refusing to let go of beauty, how we turn our face the other way. We choose to do this. Some of us will not be distracted from love. We will not allow our mouth to become a womb for war. And so I say, as I carry the light forth during our sung benediction, let us make it a habit to be the light, carrying it with us, praying it will shine for all to see. I'll go up front. Last week I told you the words of our Advent theme come from the song O Holy Night, which has an interesting history. The lyrics were written in 1843 by the French atheist poet Placide Capot, with music by the Jewish composer Adolphe Adam. In 1855, an American Unitarian minister, John Dwight, translated them into English, after which it became a popular hymn for Christian abolitionists due to the justice-focused language in verse 3. I think this beautiful Christmas song has strong connections to the Magnificat, and I'm so glad Latia is singing it for our postlude. Now for the hard part. Latia has been a soprano soloist and choral leader with our congregation for over a dozen years, and many of us know and dearly love her. This morning I share the news that, given her current family and work obligations, December 31st will be her last Sunday here with us, though she has promised to be available for some special music. I am truly sad about this, but I also know life morphs and changes over time, and this is one of those changes. So this is our morning to thank Latia and celebrate all that she has brought to our church these many years. We have a special coffee hour planned in her honor, and I hope you will join us for that. Latia, thank you.
Thank you.
Please come and continue the celebration with us in coffee hour.